Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, asking him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord, and you forgave the iniquity of my sin. O Almighty God, merciful Father, I, a poor, miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities with which I have ever offended you and justly deserved your temporal and eternal punishment. For I am heartily sorry for them and sincerely repent of them. I pray you of your boundless mercy and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor, sinful being. Upon your confession, I, as a called servant of Christ, announce the forgiveness of all of your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We pray. Almighty and everlasting God, give us an increase of faith, hope, and love, that receiving what you have promised, we may love what you have commanded. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our Old Testament reading this morning is from the book of Deuteronomy, the 7th chapter. This will also serve as the text for Pastor's message for us this morning. You are a people holy to the Lord your God. The Lord your God has chosen you to be a people for his treasured possession out of all the peoples who are on the face of the earth. It was not because you were more in number than any other people that the Lord set his love on you and chose you, for you were the fewest of all peoples. But it is because the Lord loves you and is keeping the oath that he swore to your fathers, that the Lord has brought you out with a mighty hand and redeemed you from the house of slavery, from the hand of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. Know therefore that the Lord your God is God, the faithful God who keeps covenant and steadfast love with those who love him and keep his commandments to 1,000 generations. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to
God. Our epistle reading this morning is from Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 8. We know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those whom he predestined, he also called, and those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own Son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died, more than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers, nor height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus, our Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Please stand. Our gospel reading this morning is from the book of St. Matthew, the 13th chapter. Jesus said, "The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field, which a man found and covered up. Then in his joy he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls, who on finding one pearl of great value went and sold all he had and bought it. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was thrown into the sea and gathered fish of every kind. When it was full, men drew it ashore and sat down and sorted the good into containers, but threw away the bad. So it will be at the close of the age. The angels will come out and separate the evil from the righteous and throw them into the fiery furnace. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Have you understood all these things?" They said to him, "Yes." And he said to them, "Therefore, every scribe who has been trained for the kingdom of heaven is like a master of a house who brings out of his treasure what is new and what is old." This is the gospel of the Lord. You may be seated for the sermon hymn.
Thank you. now. There we go. It sounds like it's through. Let me restart. Grace and peace to you from our God, our Father, and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Who are you? I want you to seriously consider that question with me for just 1 second, because I think it's an important question. Who are you? Now, I thought that this would be a good question to use for my first sermon because many of you probably don't know who I am. So I figured this would be an appropriate time for me to share some things about myself, but in order for me to share with you, I need you to help me out a little bit. And don't worry, I usually don't ask for participation in my sermon, so you don't have to sweat it out like that, but for today, I would like a little help. When I point to you or even gesture, I just need you to ask me one question. Who are you? So let's give it a shot. There we go. We'll get there. I'm your new associate pastor, Jarod, and I'm very excited to be here with you all. I get to share the gospel with you. I get to work with the youth and share Christ with them. I get to walk alongside you for years to come through the best moments in your lives and some of the hardest. It is truly a blessing, and I am looking forward to every minute of it to come. Well, I'm a mountain biker. I love the thrill of this sport, the adrenaline of racing down a small trail through trees. And not only that, by the time I get done, man, I'm so tired. It's such a good workout, but it clears my mind. I find myself at peace, able to reflect on my life, and usually say a little prayer when I make it to the car for a safe ride and a good life. Well, I didn't know if you guys would keep going with it, but I'm glad you are. I'm a fisher. I love to be out on a calm and still lake, especially just like this picture. There's nothing like this tranquility that can be found being by yourself. The boat's not really rocking. You can reflect on everything that's going on. And once again, you can truly pray, giving thanks for God's beautiful creation and everything that He has done. Man, this is the toughest one. I'm a sinful human being. I'm broken and in need of a Savior. So who are you? I asked that question and I hope that some things did come to mind. But what did come to mind for you? Did you think of your job first? Is that what defines you? Or maybe you thought of that activity that you enjoy doing more than anything else. Or maybe you thought about your spouse or your kids, or if you are a kid, you thought of your parents or going to school. All those different vocations you have, maybe that's what defines you. Whatever the case may be, I think the answer is complicated, and it's diverse, and it is constantly changing. We're never the same person day to day because things are constantly happening. We're redefining ourselves. Whatever the case may be, did you think, I'm a believer, I'm saved, I'm a sinner? I'm in need of being saved. Maybe you did, maybe you didn't. That's fine. Whatever came to mind, that's okay. But the reason I point this out is because I think this question of who am I is asking a much more important question. Deep down, I think it's asking, what is my value? Why am I important? Why am I even here? Who am I? You see, we live in a world of perceived value. Look out into any market in today's world. You'll find one company that everybody knows, and it's so expensive, and their competitors, maybe just as good quality, it's like a half the price or a fraction of the price. Why is that? Perceived value. Many of you might know it better as supply and demand. The reason something's so expensive is because of our want and where we place our value, how much we want something. Let me say that for you again, because that's going to be very important for this message today. The reason is something is valuable. It has nothing to do with the thing itself. It's the fact that we want it and desire it so badly. Notice the order that I shared about myself today. Pastor, mountain biker, fisher, sinner. That didn't happen by accident. I shared with you first the things that I thought made me important, the things that I thought made me valuable, the things I want you to know about me because I want to feel valuable. I want to feel desired, as we all do. And then at the bottom of the list goes those things we don't want people to know, like the sinfulness. It's almost like we're creating a resume for ourselves, tiering what we think makes us valuable. And unfortunately, in today's world, one of the first things that goes to the bottom of that list is our faith, especially in those times when we're not with people who believe, especially in those times when we know if we share that, we might be judged or ridiculed for it. So it goes at the bottom. We don't share that side of us. Or maybe more appropriate today, because we are in a house full of believers, we hide the fact that we're sinful. We hide the fact that we're broken. We make it seem like we got it all put together because it seems like everybody else does. And I just want to be able to run the race like everybody else. So I hide those facts. You see, the sad truth is that this is a learned behavior. Once you get burned once, once you share one fact about yourself and the outcome is ridicule or being left alone and your life just feels a little bit more broken, you learn real fast, don't you? That aspect gets put to the bottom of the list. That's not coming out again. I'm not going to make myself vulnerable like that again. I'm valuable. I'm important. That's what people are going to know about me. Our text for today comes from Deuteronomy. So as a quick recap, because again, it's important, Deuteronomy is a retelling of what Moses had to say to God's people. If you remember Israel, they spent a lot of time in slavery, and then they wandered for 40 years. But for us to really understand why this message is important for God's people, we need to understand who Israel was, who the nation was. In fact, we're going to kind of look at it like a resume. Why was Israel important? Why did they warrant God's attention? So let's start. First off, they were a small nation. In fact, our text says they were the smallest nation around. That doesn't look so good on their resume. Keep going. It turns out they're not a strong warrior tribe, nation, or anything like that. They weren't the most skilled in any craft because, again, they were slaves for so long, and then they wandered for 40 years. How could they hone a craft that well? So they're small. They're not the best at anything. But we keep going. And then the worst one comes. They weren't even faithful. If you remember, after God brought them out of slavery, they started to wonder what was going to happen. So they made their own idol, something they could pray to, something to make them feel like they had control. So they're a small nation. They're not the best at anything, and they are unfaithful. You tell me, does it seem like they warrant God's attention and love? I don't think so. But to our surprise, God does want them. In fact, he wants them more than anybody else, more than anything else. Hear these words again from the text. The Lord your God has chosen you to be people for his treasured possession. You see, it wasn't the Israelites that made themselves valuable. It was the fact that God wanted them so deeply. That's what made them valuable. That's why he treasured them. Regardless of everything they were, he wanted them so much. In fact, he goes as far to say that his treasured people here are his holy nation. And for those of you who don't know, holy, it means set apart. It's a term that we usually use for God because he's set apart from his creation. Or Jesus Christ because he was set apart from mankind, being 100% God and 100% man. Or the Bible. It's set apart from all those other books because it is God's word. And now we have Israel set apart for God from all other peoples. So you might be asking yourself, what does that have to do with us today? Dear friends, it has everything to do with us today. We are God's holy people. We have been given a new identity. We may not be the most powerful nation. We may not be the biggest. We may not be the most skilled. And yes, we turn away in thought, word, and deed as we confess on Sunday morning. But the good news is that we have an eternally faithful God who never strays from his people, his precious possession. Our God is the very same God as he was at the beginning of creation, as he was with the Israelites at the Jordan River, as he is today, and as he will be for the next 1,000 or 1,000,000 years. He stays true to his covenant, literally to the point of sending his only son to the cross for you and for me. And I know this gets said a lot, but I want you to think about it in a different way. Our God knew everything that was going to happen before he separated light from darkness. He knew your path from the start. He knew who you were going to be, and he loved you deeply. He loved you so deeply, in fact, before he decided to set everything in motion, he knew he was going to have to send his son to die on the cross, and he did it anyway. He loves you that deeply, that immensely. That is a God who is going to stay true to you forever. When you were baptized, you received the Holy Spirit, and that means no matter who you were, no matter who you'd grow up to be, the thing that gives you value, the most important title you will ever have, is being Christ's disciple, is being God's child. And that comes with so many blessings. It means you get to come here and confess your sins, or confess your sins daily to a God who wants to hear them and forgive you daily, repeatedly, over and over again. It means you get to come here on a Sunday and receive Holy Communion and be reminded of who you are. Be strengthened in your faith as God's child. I implore you, I invite you, stop fighting tooth and nail to try and sell yourself like that resume. Instead, live powerfully, confidently in this new identity. Because being Christ's child means no matter who you are, no matter what you've done, no matter how bad you feel, you are invited to come to the cross and confess your sins. And I promise you the response will always be from our loving Father, "I'm glad you're here." If you're wondering what this sort of confidence in being God's child looks like, look no further than our actual children here at Peace. This last week we always have childcare, but this last week when we were in childcare, we were thinking of songs to sing. We sang "Jesus Loves Me," a song I'm sure many of us are very familiar with. And we only planned on singing that first verse, the one that most everybody knows. And as us leaders were thinking about what to sing next, we were stopped. We were stopped because the children, mind you, maybe 1-year-olds up to 5, they started singing all by themselves. They just kept singing "Jesus Loves Me." The next verse, powerfully, confidently, full of joy, no worry about who would judge them. I'll be honest, it stopped me in my very tracks. You don't often see such powerful moments of faith. These kids know who Jesus is. They know that they are deeply and immensely and eternally loved. So as you go out this week, I invite you to take some of that extreme, beautiful, confident faith with you. Put that on instead of whatever it is that you think gives you value. Let go of all your anxieties and your worries, and be who you were made to be, God's precious treasure. And remember that even in those times where you might face struggle or hardship because of your faith, remember that you have the promise of victory alongside Jesus Christ on this side of the tomb. You have the promise of life eternal without challenge or struggle, and they are all yours by grace through faith in our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. I invite you to rise to sing our sermon response. faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
Seated. At this time, we will receive the offering. We are thankful for all of the support our ministry gets in your time, talents, and treasures. Gracious Heavenly Father, in praise and thanksgiving, we bring a portion of what you have first given to us to your altar in offering. We pray that you would allow these gifts to be blessed and to be used to further your kingdom on earth through Peace Lutheran Ministries. These things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. We have one change in the prayers today. Jean Kessler has passed away. We'll be praying for her family and friends. Jean was the mother of Jennifer Bolin. Let us pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Heavenly Father, you have redeemed us out of your steadfast love. Grant that the gospel may go forth unhindered, and that your Spirit may bring into this fellowship of the redeemed. Heavenly Father, grant wisdom to all who make, administer, and judge our laws, that they may seek what is best for all in accordance with your will. Bless those serving in our nation's armed forces with bravery and honor as they protect and defend our rights and freedom. Protect them when duty takes them into danger, and comfort them when they are separated from family and friends. Heavenly Father, bestow your comfort upon all who are burdened by sickness and affliction, especially members Jack Greening, Nancy Hunter, Gary Seafelt, Angel Zimmerman, Cal Krieger, Bob Van Abel, and Todd Kane. For friends and family, Bob Stickney, Jan Young, John Zacek, John Hitz, Paul Walvogel, Isaac Thompson and his friend Mara, and Devin Peschke. For those injured in military service and all those we each hold in our hearts, grant them healing and comfort and give them patience as they wait on your good and gracious will. Heavenly Father, be with the family and friends of Jean Kessler. Watch over them and comfort them and encourage them in this difficult time for them as they mourn the passing of their loved one. Heavenly Father, we pray today for all the members of our Peace Lutheran family of believers and name before you Steve and Julie Hallenbeck, Evelyn Hannes, Sam Harden, Matt Harris, and Julie Harches. Bless us as we live out our Christian lives and keep us sure in the knowledge that nothing can separate us from the love of Christ. Heavenly Father, we thank and praise you for bringing Lane Elise Kradimski into your family of believers this weekend through your word in the waters of holy baptism. Bless her throughout her life and lead her to grow in her faith and in her love for you with the help of her parents and sponsors. Heavenly Father, we ask your special blessing upon our adult servant team in Alaska this week. We pray that you would keep them safe in their endeavors, and that you would strengthen them as they share your word of hope with a hurting world. Lord God, Heavenly Father, you preserve us because of your faithfulness and steadfast love. As you preserved your ancient people of Israel for the sake of your promises, keep your holy church on earth, and also preserve our synod, we pray, for the sake of your name. Lead our delegates and members gathered in convention in Milwaukee this week according to your good will and pleasure, that in word and action we may love you and keep your commandments, confessing your steadfast love and faithfulness even to 1,000 generations. Through Christ the crucified, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please stand with me as we pray the prayer our Lord taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. We continue with communion.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give him thanks and praise. Our Lord Jesus Christ, in the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples, said, "Take and eat, this is my body, given for you, for the forgiveness of your sins. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Take and drink, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you.
Please rise. Now may this, the true body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, strengthen and preserve you in body and soul to life everlasting. Depart in peace. Amen. Let us pray. O God, the Father, the fount and source of all goodness, who in loving kindness sent your only begotten Son into the flesh, we thank you that for his sake you have given us pardon and peace in this sacrament. And we ask you not to forsake your children, but always to rule our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, that we may be enabled constantly to serve you. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. I receive this blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Amen. We now join in singing our final hymn.